Okay, here we are. Wednesday night, December 28th, 2011. Looking at a teshoubah from Rabbi Haim David HaLevy, from his third volume of Mayim Hayim. It's the last volume of She'elot Teshuvot that he published before he passed away. Question is, when is it permissible to stop praying for a sick person, and when is it permissible to pray for that person to die?
Wow.
Okay?
It's heavy duty.
Yeah, it's heavy duty.
Well, we always hear about pray and read the Elim. We get a million emails and stuff, but when do you stop? Well, let's see what the rabbi has to say.
Wow.
No, well, you never heard of praying for somebody to die?
That's not true.
I never heard
when a person gets to such a bad situation, and you know they're supposed to be dying soon, but everybody's praying for them to get better, you need to, like, cut it to end.
Love should enjoy better.
But is it cutting when you're... There's a prayer for the guy to die. Yeah, please, why not?
It's a prayer for a guy to die.
David?
There's a prayer for a guy to die?
Yeah, it's not exactly... You see, you're thinking of it in a very, very, you know... I told you. In a very, very, like, crude manner, just for a guy to die. It's a guy for a guy to, like, not...
Ease his pain.
It eases pain and stop suffering and move on to the next world. You know?
No, that I got.
Okay, but
I'm saying it's not like a prayer that exists.
It is, yeah, it exists. I have to say it.
Well,
I have to say it for somebody
sick,
all the time. Yeah, of course. I had to say it for somebody, and I didn't think it was going to do anything, but within a couple of hours, that was it. That was the person. I was shocked. Okay. I was. You know, the that's person was doing, but the person was like suffering now already for over a week, and like, do this, not do this, and that. So I called up, whatever. Here, go get in this book, this page. So one day I said it, and lo and behold,
oh my God,
it worked.
He died?
Yeah.
Good man.
Listen, that's what needed to be done. Yeah, it was scary in a way. It's like,
yeah, I'm sure to have to feel that you have that.
You don't have anything.
Yeah, no, you don't. No.
It just makes you realize how feeble man is, you know. Anyway, hinei me'ashe. Okay, so here's the teshuvah. Matay mutar lehafsik lepalel al hole, matay mutar lepalel alav sheyamut. Hinei me'ashe kabbala mechtabo. Miyom yudhet b'tevet tavshin nun vav. So this is a question from 1996. B'she'elato, matay efshar lehafsik pelel al chole, lehafsik lomar tehillim v'chole, b'chole shenimshechet mahalato zeman rab. When can I stop praying for a person that's sick? That, you know, I want to stop saying tehillim. His sickness is dragging on for a very, very long time. Any odeya, im nishat et ha'she'ela b'diyu. I don't know if you used the exact correct term for the question. Shechen, im ina hode mityasir b'yusrim kashim, velo na'ashu harof'im milpuyo, v'day shehoba lehamshik palel. If the person is not suffering over excessively, and if the doctors have not given up hope to cure him, then definitely there is an obligation to keep praying for him to have a recovery, obviously. And if even the doctors have given up hope to find a way to cure him, im en sablo gedol biyoter, if he's not suffering so much, why should they stop praying for him? V'helo, aynenu ra'u ha'olim rabbim shenu anshu harofim ripuyim. We have seen in our lifetime, we've seen in our day, especially him as a, you know, as a rabbi and a chief rabbi, he had the opportunity to see many, many people that were, you know, that were sick and suffering, and the doctors gave up. Okay? Okay, and but sometimes you give up, the doctors give up, but the people don't give up. They end up, you know, getting better sometimes. And sometimes if the person is sick for a number of years, you know, 2-3 years later, they find a cure. Something that they never knew about 3 years earlier, so why give up?
Okay.
שהחולה מתייסר ביוסרים קשים. So I'm guessing that your question really means that the person that is sick is really suffering. You know, really terrible suffering, obviously. Can't take it anymore. וגם לא עשו הרופאים לרפאו. And also the doctors gave up in finding a cure. ולמעשה, כבר נשאלתי לפני כמה שנים בנושא זה. And practically, I have been asked this question before in the past. And I answered, obviously, very short, brief answer. And if you want to see what I wrote, go look in Aseh Lecharab, in the fifth volume, page 397. You'll see what I wrote about over there. And obviously, that was a number of years ago. ארחיב הדיבור בזה, כי לאחרונה שאלתי כמה פעמים בנושא זה, מן הראוי לבאר הלכה זה ומקורותיה. Okay, but lately I've been asked this question more and more, and I have to give it, you know, the proper justice to give a proper answer. וזו כבר נפתחה בגדולים. Obviously this question has been dealt with in the past. בגדולה מזו, כתב הרב בעל ארוך השולחן. And the great rabbi, the author of Aroukh Hashoulhan, Halik, I believe his name was Rabbi Baruch Epstein, if I'm not mistaken. Halik yurei di'a siman shinna medhe ot gima. Vizu lishonu. Kol ha-mibakir at ha-hole. Gorem leo shi-yihye. Shi-palei'av shi-yihye. Anytime that you go to visit a sick person, you cause this person to live. Because when you go to visit him, you wish him well. That's a form of prayer. You're praying for him to live. Vechol shi-eno mibakir. Inu mibakish alav rahamim. Lo shi-yihle. And anybody who doesn't go to visit is not asking for any mercy for this person. Not that he should live and not that he should die. Neither way. Because sometimes you need to ask for a person to die. That he has way too much suffering in his sickness. And it's impossible for him to live under those conditions like Rabbi in Perek HaNusi. This is to the extent of Rabbi Epstein in Aroukh Hashoulhan. Hine, ki chen lo zo bilbad shemuta lafsik lepalel alav shiyahyeh, ela shemuta gam lepalel shiyamut. We understand from the Aroukh Hashoulhan that not only is it permissible to stop praying for this person to live, but it's even allowed to pray for the person to pass away. Ella shalakha zot kasha ra'amumahi shloma sanu lishum aham migdoi haposkim shepasakin lahalakha. But this is very, very difficult and troublesome issue because we never found any of the great poskim that give a pasak halakha on this. The harab Aroukh Hashoulhan למד כן מדברי הר"ן בגמרא. And the Aroukh Hashoulhan came up with this concept based upon the words of the R"ן, the Binyan Nesim, the Gemara, Masechet Nedarim. וכך אמרו שם, רב, דימי אמר, כל המבקר את החולה, מבקש עליו רחמים שיחיה, וכל שאין מבקר את החולה, גורם לו שימות. So the words of the R"ן, very simple, basically what we read in the Aroukh Hashoulhan, but slightly different. רב דימי said, any person that visits the Hole, he asks for the Hamim for him to live. And anybody who does not live, who does not visit, causes the person to die. Not visiting the sick causes the sick person to die. That's what he says. Umaksheha Gemara. Obviously the Gemara is a question. My Gemara, what do you mean he causes him to die? Okay?
Illima. Somebody close or just
Anybody
that you're not visiting who's sick?
Obviously, people don't just visit you anybody like that. Right. People that you would normally visit.
If you're not visiting them purposely?
Yeah. Uh-huh. You're not visiting purposely. I guess you. Somebody, let's say, a friend of yours. You would normally go visit him or you'd hang out with him and say, okay, the guy's sick. I didn't go. So, because you didn't go, you didn't care about him enough. You're causing him to die. That's what it's saying.
Strong words.
It's very strong words. But you have to also understand.
So you're saying if somebody's sick.
Go ahead.
Right, if somebody's sick that you know, that you have to go see him. Like, if he's not, if he's not like on his deathbed.
Excuse me. Not that you'd know. Okay, because then everybody will be visiting people with their own.
Someone you really know, a great uncle, a great somebody aunt, Tom.
Yeah, it has to be somebody you're closer with. I'm going to look at it like this. Nowadays, people pass away. Everybody, Tyree, Tom, Dick, and Harry shows up at the Beit Eved. Okay? You have, I don't know, over the course of the week, you get close to 1,000 people, at least. In some cases, more. Would these 1,000 people have ever, at any time in their life, ever visited this person in their home? Where they're all showing up at the guy's home now, because he's dead? Isn't there something strange?
Yeah, mine was that in the book.
Went crazy. He goes, Mr. A never ever went to see Mr. B in his house. Ever. They knew each other all their lives, but they never visited each other in each other's home.
And the guy died.
Now Mr. B dies. Mr. A is there every day. What are you doing there? You never went to the other one's alive. You're showing up now when he's dead? What, better late than never? I understand.
So it's better not to go to Beit Aviv?
Who are you consoling? So people can say, who's this guy? Where do you come from? I never saw him before in my life.
I've said that many times.
True.
No, seriously.
That's true.
When you sat for your father, you know, people showed up and you're like, right. Who's this guy? What's he doing here? You know? I don't know. Well, you know.
Somebody knows somebody.
So what's he doing here? The guy is coming to console you. He's going to comfort you. What's he doing there?
But that's what also became. It became like custom enough.
It became a social scene.
Someone you sort of know if it's, you know.
Somebody you ever saw in your life.
Not a custom.
Not a custom, it became.
It's a social scene, right.
It's a social scene. You go, here. Last night we were at a meet the family. Ralph Mizrahi's not here tonight, got engaged yesterday.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
very nice. Ralph Mizrahi, my brother-in-law, got engaged yesterday.
Oh, very nice. Who?
Rosie Marachi.
Marachi.
Ah. Marachi.
Okay.
Okay.
I'll pause here, because Nick will leave comments.
You don't know him. Anyway. How many people in the house? 50, 60, well, okay. It was social scene, nice, hang out, this, some people are sitting, some people are standing, some people are talking, some people are eating, some people are drinking. You go to a Beit Eved, what do you see?
Same thing.
Come hang out. Yeah, let's talk, let's laugh. People are joking with each other. It's a very jovial atmosphere. That's not what it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be very, very solemn, very quiet, very, you know, you're supposed to sense the tragedy.
At least the first few days.
The first 3 days, yeah. At the very least.
The first 3 days.
But you don't feel it.
No.
From day one.
People come in the first day.
From the first minhag.
The whole day.
From the first minhag, it's one big joke.
It really is.
Come, let me make a meal for you. Let's make us up a restaurant over here. Let's have a caterer. What's going on here? Anyway, so let's go back to the Gemara. Because the Gemara really is a basis for the same thing, though. So,
wow, I just got the bill from the Habarak Adisha, by the way.
So, Henry?
Holy moly. Nobody died. It's not worth it.
Well, what's the price nowadays?
Crazy? $10,000.
$10,000.
And that's without the stone.
Oh, my God.
This is here? To be very good.
Yeah.
My grandma. Illi ma. Kul mishin bakish tahole. Me bakish ala avrahani shiyahyeh. בכל שאין מבקר את החולה, מבקש עליו רחמים שימות. שימות, סלקה דעתך. אלא, כל שאין מבקר את החולה, אין מבקש עליו רחמים, לא שיחיה ולא שימות. So, okay, obviously when you go into the person, you're praying for him, for his well-being, so, you know, so that he gets healthy, that he lives. And if you're not going over there, so you're not praying for him, so that's like say he dies. No, not really that he died, but rather you don't care either way. Whether the guy lives, whether the guy dies, whatever goes. Because that's Haran Sham, and the Ran wrote to explain the sugya of the Gemara. كيسريخ لبقيش رحميم على حوله شيموت كي قونش مستعير حوله بحوليو هربي في شالو شيحيه كيد أمنينا بفرق النوسي دي كيفان شي حزاي أماتي دي ربي دي عالكاما زمنين لبيتك كيسي بأنا في اللين لكا مستعير أمرا يرسون شي خبو هعليونيم إذا تحتونيم كلو مار تدي يموت ربي ومشوم هاخي كأمار ده مبكرة حوله معيلو بتلاتو في اللون حيات إبلي شهيد في الله يوتم معيلة. Alright, let's go back for a second. So he's saying that the Ran writes, it seems to me that when a person says at times that you have to ask rahamim, you have to ask for mercy for the sick person, she yamut. You know, you see that hole is suffering, they're having a hard time with their sickness. And it's impossible to go on living like that. Okay? Like we have a situation, Masechet Kiddushin, that the friends of Rabbi, they saw. How many times could the guy go to the bathroom and he takes off his tefillin and he can't deal with the suffering because obviously he had either it was a stomach issue or a rectal issue, whatever the case may be. So they said, you know, inshallah, let things, you know, change. Let the top become the bottom, let the bottom become the top. In other words, let everything just, you know, flip around and he'll get so sick that he'll just die. Rabbi. Okay? So that's what they say. When you go to visit a person, you help him out with your prayer. Okay? Even if it's to live, or it's that you see that he's not going to be able to live, and but the other way. Okay, because the prayer is going to help either way. The guy's going to see that you're there, you care for him, you care about him.
Thank you.
And somebody doesn't visit him. Okay, and somebody doesn't visit him, doesn't mean that you don't care if he lives or not. هنا أميتا أفلو أتا هنا زطرتي إنو منهاتو go along with it. Right. It's like you don't care, whatever happens. Maybe I'll pray for my heart, but the guy needs to also sense the feeling of it. مفرش يسي شعال حولي شمت يسي بحليو. So obviously we understand very, very clear that a person that has a lot of suffering, a lot of pain and anguish with a sickness, ואין שום סיכוי שתרפא, and there is no chance. No chance whatsoever that he's going to be cured and he'll return to his normal self. Mutar leitpaler alev sheyamut. It's permissible to pray that he dies. Echmosha aseta shifhato shel Rabbi sheyipaler alev sheyamut. The same way, like the shifha of Rabbi prayed for him that he should die. She saw it's going to be impossible. The guy cannot be cured. Not able to live like this. Let him go, Hazit. Don't let him suffer. Ela sheka amur shum eha megedula poskin lo hizkiru. But like, as we said above, there was no posik that ever gave a, want to call it a heter, you know, an allowance to pray for a person to die. And most probably because they explained the Gemara in Nedarim like Rashi explained it. Share in Oyodeya be Anyanosha Hode. She goes, yes, you're not praying for the guy that he should live or die because you don't know what the situation is. So you didn't see, so you're not praying for him. So it's not that you care or don't care, it's that you don't know, and that's it. You just don't know. So it's not that you're praying for him to die. Ubeemet she piruze kashe biyotin. But the truth is, it's a very difficult pirush for Rashi to say something like that. Mm-hmm. If you say there is no heter to pray for a person to die, what do you mean? So he shouldn't live and shouldn't die. There's an extra wording. And we don't generally find extra wording in the Gemara. The Gemara could have just said, well, he's not praying for him to live. Even we look at it, the explanation of the Ran and Bin al-Nusim is difficult for us to explain the, and understand this Gemara. And the Maharsha already realized this difficulty. If you look at the words of Rab Dimi, it says everybody that prays, that does not pray for the Hole, causes him to die. Ul Pirush Haran al Sugya Hazar Bom Migrasazot. And if you look at the Pirush of the Ran, it really goes back and changes it. Ayin Shahiteb, Kilonu Khalharik Bisitut Kodwara, but this is not the place to get into, he tells you. You want to go study, go look at the Anyan over there in the Gemara and look at the Mefarshi. ועוד קשה על פירוש הר"ן שכבר ידוע בהלכה שאסור לגרום בשום פנים למותו של אדם. ועוד על פירוש of the ר"ן, it very established in הלכה, you know, it doesn't go hand in hand because it's אסור to cause anybody to move. I pray to God, I want this guy to drop it. You know, what is that? You can't do that. ואפילו ברגעיו האחרונים, and even at the last moments of life, כשהוא גוסס, when he's like, gets it, he's at the, those last breaths, וכך שנינו, הגוסס הרי הוא כחי. The gosses, even though you think the guy is on his deathbed, he's dead the last moments, no, he's like כחי. לכל דבריו. He is considered a living human being for every, you know, in every instance. אם מעצמין עיניו, we don't close his eyes. רבי מאיר אומר, משל לנר שהוא מטפטף. Like a flame, it's flickering. כיוון שנגע בו אדם, מחבהו כך. You know, once you touch that flame, obviously it's going to go out. But if you leave it alone, leave it alone. It's still going. Same thing. The guy's eyes are open, leave it alone. Don't close his eyes. Once you close his eyes, you're telling the guy goodbye. You're shutting him off. וכן פסק הרמה. And the Ramah, you read the Asimman Shin Lamittet. וכן אסור לגרום למת שימות. מהירה. כגון מישהו גוסה זמן ארוך, אסור. ולא יוכל להיפרד, אסור להשמיט. Okay, the guy is suffering, you see that he's on his deathbed, the last five moments, you cannot speed it up whatsoever. Okay? והרב ארוך השולחן עצמו כתב שם, and if you go back to ארוך השולחן, what is he right? ואף על פי שמסתער הרבה, even though he's suffering a lot, בטוב לו למות, and it's better for him to die, מקום מקום, אסור לנו לעשות דבר לקרב מיטתו. It's not forbidden us for us to do anything to haste his death. והעולם ומלואו של הקדוש ברוך הוא. Everything belongs to the Olam. Who are we to decide the thing? We can't be God. We can't play his role. וכך לסורו יברך. This is what he wants. We have to leave it. ואם כן, איך הוא עצמו פסק כאן שמותר לקרב מיטתו על ידי תפילה? So if he himself said this, how did he say we could pray for the guy that he should die? והלו גם זה נגד רצון יברך. This prayer itself is against Borei Olam's will. ואף על פי שבתפילה אין שום מעשה בידיים. Even though we're praying, we're not actually doing anything physical. We're not using our hands, we're not touching, we're not nothing. Hey, I'm praying to you, Borei Olam, between me and you. נגד רצון יברך שנותן לו חיי שעה אלא חיי שעה אלא ואין הוא דומה למקרב מיטתו בידיים. I'm not going close his eyes, I'm not doing anything. ואף על פי כן, איך מותר לפלל להשם יתברך שיעשה נגד רצונו? How can we pray to God to do something against his will? זאת ועוד, הלא ייתכן שכל רגע נוסף של ייסורים קשים הם זיכוך וזיכוך לחולה זה לכפר על עוונותיו. And you can look at it the other way. Every moment of pain and suffering, this could clean his neshama, and he could, you know, and he could wipe out more and more avonot. And even the greatest righteous person, he's still a human being, and he has done avonot. So if God wants him to go this way to clear up whatever avonot and clear his neshama, who are you to decide to speed that up? So now if you're there, you're with him, you want to so help the guy do teshuvah at his last moments. Why do you want to just, you know, pray for the guy to die? Help him pray for himself that he should do teshuvah. Bine af shalom asanu le gedolei haposkim shepasku lehatir lepalel al hole sheyemut. Adayin ein vidda'ut shem halukim al haran And even though, like we said before, we didn't find any of the poskim that wrote a pesach halacha to allow us to pray for a sick individual to pass on, you know, maybe there was a reason why they didn't write about it. Maybe they didn't have a reason to write about it. ולמרות מה שעקשו על פירוש הר"ן בסוגיה דנדרים, הלו גם הר"ן הוא מגדולי הפוסקים. But the R'an himself is one of the great poskim. ולפחות לא מסרנו שחלקו על הפירוש. And we didn't find anybody that actually wrote out against him and lashed out for Adam for what he wrote. ולחות דבריו מכוח קושות. And we can't just negate whatever he wrote because we have questions. ומרן הגאון רבי חיים פלאצ'י מגדולי פוסקי הדורות האחרונים נשאל ממש כשאלה הזאת. רבי חיים פלאצ'י, as we all know, was the chief rabbi of Izmir. He was one of our greatest Sephardi poskim, early 1800s. And Rabbi Haim David HaLevy is telling us that he was asked our exact question. Reuben Yireh Hashem בית המיד חכם ויש לו אישה יראת השם בחלתה חולי ארוך סמן רב למעלה מ-20 שנה. So we had Reuven, religious guy, Yirei Shamayim, תמיד חכם, and he has a religious wife, okay, and she got sick, and she was sick for a long time, more than 20 years. She נתכבסו איבריה ידי ורגליה. She couldn't use any of her, you know, of her joints, any of her limbs, nothing. And she was suffering with terrible pain as well. Okay, her husband accepted it. This is what it is. No problem that he didn't look sad for it and he didn't make her sad about it. He would show her extra love and extra care and extra compassion just so she wouldn't feel any pain or suffering. She couldn't stand it anyway, and she would pray to Borei Olam that he would kill her, just so she can rest from her suffering. And her husband and children would try to pacify her. They would bring the doctors and all types of medications, anything they could come, get their hands on, any sort of ideas, anything, no stone unturned. And they brought her nurses and aides and you name it. They brought it to, so she could, you know, have whatever she wanted at her beck and call. And now she got even sicker and she has even more pain and suffering than ever before. And even all the doctors gave up. And now she's asking them, please pray for me to die. ובפרט מתחננת היא לבעלה ובניה שהם יבקשו רחמים על ככה. And now she's pleading with her husband and children, I want you, okay, you pray to God, you do this for me, okay, pray for me to God, okay, let God have mercy on me, like this. והם מרוב חיבה ואהבה אינם שועים לה, but because they care for her and love her so much, they don't want to listen to her. ואדרבה מבקשים תלמידי החכמים שילמדו לרפואתה, and they're calling החכמים to come, you know, and say Torah, and let this be a זכות for her to be healed. יורדנו המורה, אם יש חשש איסור לבקש עליה רחמים, שתמות כדי שתנוח נפשה או לא. So they're asking רבי חיים פלאצ'י, tell us, is it אסור to ask God to have mercy on her and let her pass on, so she can just rest? פעם תמסילו מה דדקה איסור אם בעלה ובניה חסים על חייה. And you say, no, there's no איסור for her husband and her children, you know, they care about her and her life. האם יוכלו לבקש לחיים שלא תמות ולא ישגיחו בה? They ask for mercy, for her not to die, and not, then they just won't care about her. Just let her, you know, let her go any way she goes. Or dilma kevan de antik va'lahiot, but or on the flip side, if there's no hope for her to live, al pi erufim, based upon what the medical practitioners are saying. Min atik vesh tehiyeh derech teba'ah, and there's no way for her to live natural, normal life. Im ken adrabah zehu naha ruach lah yurehem murenu. And maybe really is the ultimate compassion, the ultimate mercy for her, is to just pray for her to pass on. She doesn't suffer anymore because the doctors can't do anything, and leaving her without medications is also obviously not an answer. What should we do?
So, I still don't think it's to pass on. I think it's just to go.
Go, pass on,
easy.
Just
go
die.
Easy, don't suffer anymore.
No, it's not, don't suffer anymore.
Die,
that's the only way. Because if you're saying just don't suffer anymore, so you want to be cured. We're saying not cured. We're saying die.
I'm saying, okay, die, but die, okay, just go.
Go, obviously
right.
Go.
Right.
Go, no more suffering. Stop
right.
It all.
Yep.
Just, turn off the respirator.
Right.
Okay, so obviously, they're asking this question from behind Palacci. Okay, yurenu morenu, uscheru kefu min ha-shamayim. So he's saying this question that was presented to him is built from two different angles. Harishon, in bichlal yesh hashash isul lebakesh rahayim al haleh sheyamut. Okay, is there any nuance of a forbidden act to ask mercy for a person to pass away? V'im nomar she'en isul b'kach, and if we say there is no isul, im mutar ha-hefich, is the opposite also permissible? Lebakesh rahayim al haleh kazeh sheyehyeh. Are we willing to ask, for mercy for this person that's in such a sick condition to live? Shemikivan she'en kol tikva lehiya. Okay, since there is no person, no hope for the person to live. Nimsa shegonim la'sar b'tfilah hazot. We're causing the person to suffer even more than they already are. Ki adrabah naharuach hu. Because it would be, an act of kindness to give this person some rest and let them die. Gidulato shel morei harar b'chayim Palacci yedua umfurseret. Obviously, we know he was a great hacham. V'hinei b'tshubato al she'ela zot anu hashim lo et gidulato b'tora b'lbad gam et habanato ha'amuka b'torat nefesh. Not only we see his great chokhmah as a rabbi, as a posek, but we also understand, we see his clarity and his depth in Torah HaNefesh, in understanding the human being. Okay, how a person thinks, the social aspect of halakha and of life. Ki inneha rab, פותח תשובתו בגודל האיסור לבקש רחמים על מיטת הזולת אפילו הוא אויבו ושונאו. You heard David? He opens up his teshuvah with the severity of the sin to ask God to kill somebody off, even if it's his greatest enemy. ואדרבה, חייבה תורה לעזור לו בשעת צרתו. And not only that, you have to go and help him if he is having a problem. Ka'amur. Like the Pasuk says, Kitir eh hamos, akhar, obes, tahmustao, vahadatam, azob, lo azob, fa'azor imu. Okay? You see the guy. He sees hamor. Okay? And it's falling under his burden. Okay? And you left him. You can't. You have to go out and you have to help. Kol shekin. Al abidat gufo. All the more so, obviously, for his own body. V'lo gara'aze meqlel she'asur. Forbidden to curse somebody. V'kol she'ken be'ishto she'hayag ahabat gufo. And all the more so, obviously, for his wife. That you must love your wife like you love yourself. V'harbe behirba desatet medabre rabotenu begodel ha'isur b'mi she'hoshev al ishto she'tamut b'yisa aheret. And obviously, he dealt with the issue, and this is something he dealt with in many areas of the writings of the Hachamim, that people would think in a negative way of their wife, and they would pray for them to pass away, to die, so because you know what, that G over there is cuter. I want her instead. 100%. Big issue, obviously. And it's talked about in many places in the post game. So he went into that situation as well. V'amru, atahroj al-reyafa ra'a. Okay, don't sow evil, even for somebody that's what you call that's your enemy. This is the person who considers divorcing his wife, or all the more so for her to pass away. And he discussed at length, you know, the severity of this sin. And he arrived at a conclusion. Mikol elin shemainan the isur gemur lebakesh rahamim al shum briyash tamud bechod sheken al ishto sheik gufo. You cannot ask somebody to die, and all the more so for your wife because she is like yourself. Ve'lomet teshubato zot shel Maran ha-Gaon Rabbi Haim Palacci zech sadik lebracha omet tama. When you, the reader, you open up the book Hikke Kaleb of Rabbi Haim Palacci, and you start reading this teshuvah, and you're like, what's going on? The guy asked the question, can I pray? Can I not pray? Can somebody else pray? And he's giving a whole big, you know, write-up. You know, and he goes on. When he writes in a very, very lengthy style. Why did the rabbi open up and give this whole discussion about the issue of cursing or hating, you know, the wife? And the question is the exact opposite. The husband loves her more than he loves himself. Does anything to relieve her suffering. She's the one that's asking him and the kids pray for her so she can pass away, so stop suffering after all the 20 plus years. Mm-hmm. They're not listening to her. So what purpose was him to write all this that he wrote until now? But he himself continues in this teshuvah. Ve'omer Beram kozenir e dehainu. After he finishes everything, what did Rabbi Haim Palacci say? Everything I talked about until now is when there's a possibility that maybe you don't care for your wife, you hate your wife, or you know what, let me just pray. She's not going to know that I'm praying anyway. I'll pray for her to drop dead. Okay? Okay, but that's not the case over here, obviously. And in this case over here, that he's done everything in his power. And now she's asking, she's begging him, please pray for her. I cannot take it anymore. I cannot take the physical suffering. You know, so if that type of the case, if Shar Lomar de Mutar, it is... That, you know, it's not unrealistic to say that it is permissible. Illa shehiluk peshut ze. Okay, but this small difference, a slight, a fine line. Mevin kol bar berab de had yoma, umasore chayad ol eftoa bahar saad kol de repetiha al godl hayu ve isu ve chule, ul haleg me dondi de, ve hev de barim peshti me od. Now, anybody who has a bit of common sense knows what people are really like. And if you just came and said, yeah, okay, you can pray for the dog, people, you know, let's kiss the G, I don't need her anymore. You know, he knows what people are like. He realizes, you know, people are selfish, people are greedy, people have
jealousy,
people have physical urges, whatever the case may be. So he realized that, and that's why he had to give a whole long introduction explaining, you know, the connection between husband and wife, and the caring, and the connection, and the unity, you know, before anything else. And once he established that, then only, obviously, in a difficult situation like the one at hand, then we could say that, yes, listen to her and do that, but you can't do this, you know, something on your own. אבל מהמשך הדברים יבין הלומד כוונת הרב שירד בעומק הבנתו ולכן נפשו של האדם, ולכן הוזקק להקדמה הזאת, כמו שנפרש להלן. פיין. תחילה מבי הרב סיפור מותו של רבי. So the beginning, Rabbi Haim Palacci opens up with the story about the death of Rabbi, like we read before in the Sefer Ketubot. Shebiyom moto, the day of his death, Gezru HaChamim Ta'anit. The HaChamim established a Ta'anit. Ubikshu Alav Rahamim. And they asked for mercy. Ve'amru, Kol mi shiomar, Naha nafsho shel Rabbi, Yitkar b'chelem. Anybody who says that Rabbi's Neshama is now resting, let's stab this guy with a sword.
Intense.
Okay,
well, let's take a he's dead?
Yeah, you know, people are saying he's dead, he's resting, you know. Well, let's take a spear and let's nail these people that are saying this. Alta Shifha told a gag. His Shifha went up to the roof. She prayed and said, "As Yonim Bakshim et Rabbi, up above, you're asking for Rabbi. And down here, down below, we're asking for Rabbi. Let's hope that the people down here will be able to outrule and outweigh the request up above. Obviously, the people down here want to be here with us, and the people upstairs in the Shalom, they want to take Rabbi up there. So obviously, she's saying, you know, let the prayers of the people over here take over and, you know, and sway what's going on in Shemayim. Kevin shara'ata shenichnas Rabbi lebet kiseh kama pa'amim kiyaya hulim ma'av, like we said before, since she saw that Rabbi went to the bathroom to relieve himself a number of times, because obviously he had intestinal sickness, she says over here, ve'halas tefillin mista'ir, and he had to take off his tefillin each time, and he was suffering, and it was didn't bother him, amra, she said, yirason, she changed her prayer. Said, you know what? Let the prayers and the wishes of up above outweigh those of down here. And the Hachamim never stopped asking mercy for him. Even though they knew they were praying opposite and differently than what she was saying, and she obviously knew him better than anybody else, and she was a hachama, and she had Yirat Hashem. And by them praying, they obviously delayed the death of Rabbi. Lakha shifhato kad vizarkato mehagag. She took a pitcher, and she threw it from the roof. They shut up for a second. What happened? What's going on? Okay. So she went, she's praying, and then and Rabbi died.
Wow. Because they stopped praying.
They stopped for a second. She was able to overcome them.
Oh,
good. So obviously, from the story, we learn very, very close, you know, in a very, very clear manner, that it is permissible to ask for mercy for a sick person that there is no more hope for, and the person cannot take it anymore, they're suffering so much, just ask for them to just die. Shim lokin lo hayita ha-gemara bi-asipur zeh lelo kol tegua. Otherwise, what was the whole purpose of the Gemara bringing this story that had no other purpose in the Gemara, and there's no other comment about it in the Gemara? That no way the story appears and the story ends. So obviously the story is there to teach us a lesson. Do we know what to do when we have a difficult situation? And not asking questions now. No, the Hakamim didn't agree. They prayed the way that, you know, how people get.
What is it, Ketubot?
What? Mosseri Ketubot, yeah. V'atakshe sh'ari hachamim lo hiskimu l'shifhato shel Rabbi. V'yemshichu b'tfillah. V'yesh l'mon mizeh et ha-hefech. And don't go and start learning the upset. No, you can never give up, and you always have to keep praying to Borei Olam, and he's waiting for our prayers. You know how people talk. Okay? And kin hadabar. This is not the way things are. No, the Hachamim should have yelled at her when she started praying for Rabbi to die. They knew, obviously, according to this. Call me Shawan Nahan of Shoshribi, Kalba Hidakeba Hirim. Right, because they said anybody who says they know he's not suffering, he's resting. You know, he's going to be, you know, he'll stay with the spear. Because she can't pelel al moto, and all the more so to pray for his death. And from their silence, we see what she has diku ota ila shenuy alhu kader e misaar hagadol. They know that she obviously she knew the situation better than the men. She obviously was more aware of his suffering than they were. Therefore, they continued with their prayer. They didn't know how bad it was. About the day, she saw the car. But she was the one that was more correct than anybody else. It's not so clear cut. Obviously, we need to explain the story better, etc. How come Rabbi Haim Palacci had to bring this story? Why didn't he bring a more simple story that, you know, you could just take a face value from Baba Masi'a? Rabbi Yohanan, Shahachamim b'kshu ala b'lachamim, b'nachanav shu, the Hachamim prayed for him, and he was, that's it. And he stopped, and he rested, he passed away. Obviously, Haim Palacci is familiar with this sugya of the Gemara of Masi'a. But over there, there wasn't enough evidence to prove his point.
He doesn't know this sugya.
Obviously, he's saying.
It's not detailed enough.
He knew, of course he knew.
Right, yeah, obviously he knew. He's saying, obviously he knew, but why didn't he bring that sugya? Because it's not enough of a basis, not to you know, to back up this, you know, his position. Over there, he got confused, Rabbi Yohanan, from all the sa'ar, from the suffering. Al-shigaran moto, Rish Lakish. And he ended up causing the death of Rish Lakish. So this has something to do with somebody that's sick and should die or not die. Now we're going to come to the bottom line halakha that the rabbi laid down for them. And it actually made a compromise for them. Exactly. Pesharah's a compromise. Very good, Ezra. And even though the specific woman in his case was suffering a lot, and she gave up all hope for any cure, in any case, her husband and her children and all her brothers should not make any prayer for her or any request for her to pass the best way to die. Rather, they should just not do anything at all. Just sit back and don't do. And his reasoning for this is very interesting. And it all has to do with his initial opening and his whole introduction that he gave. But obviously, it doesn't seem like he's going to get to it over here. If they ask mercy for her, they should die. You know, he doesn't want anybody to think, even at the off chance, that maybe they had something to gain by, we'll call it, killing her off. You know, or that people will start talking, or by himself start praying for her to die. You know, what would happen? She'll die, and this will come out of it, and this, you know.
The house, the insurance.
Whatever. Whatever the case, I don't want any of this. Okay, that way, just don't pray for her. Especially the people start talking. Look, look at this guy, he's praying for his wife to die. You know, also the one day they're calling Hachaim to come to sit and read Tehillim for her, you know, and have a class so she can live, and the next day they pray for her to drop dead. Come. We're going to have a cholesterol. Well, for what? For the drop. What is that? And then if they prayed, we have to do it in public. They do it privately. Nobody has to know about it. It's a psychological answer, and it's very deep. We have to be concerned. When they pray for death, to source b'libam ha'shava ahat minni alif, give them 1 in 1,000 chance that they get a little spark that kindles inside their heart. Should kabel tefillatam, gam kedei lipater mitrahata, they want to give up, I had enough of this already, and she's suffering for 20 plus years, I had it with it, that I'm not living life because of her, let her just drop that already, let's finish from this so I don't have to suffer with her. Ubaana, she may convey a hat mini alif and tosh the movies I had. Yeah, I had enough. This hasn't been a life for me. I need to go find myself somebody else. If he's gonna stop praying, all different things may enter his mind. Velachin Higdim Ptihat Shubato the Ta'ir Kama Gedol Isur Ze. And that's why he opened up his entire Teshuva talking about how what kind of Isur this is. Umasakim Harak Teshuvato, and in the end he summarizes his Teshuva, Mikum Makum, Hayashar. Don't make any tefillah for her at all. Not to live, not to die. Leave it alone. The Hakham also adds a reason that is sensible and it's ethical and it's something that we could connect to. Shorat derech eres v'rahamanut al shishar b'saro hagam ki hu asir d'rahim aliyah hari ika sad idach nisa. He goes, this is somebody who's been his life partner. You know, what kind of care and compassion does it show? You obviously, if you don't care about her, you don't care about yourself, and this is the mother of your children. How are you praying for her like that? You can't do that. You know, it's going to create negativity and, you know, and hostility between you and the kids later on in life. Well, basof musif harab. In the end, the rabbi adds, "Ve'gam le'paleh aliha shtehyeh hanami kashish sube yisurin kashiyu mariyu mista'ayet harbim." Well, we're going to keep praying for her to live so she could suffer more and more. What is that? Neshev ve'al ta'aseh adif le'gabib aliha baniha.
Okay.
You can't do that. You can't do this. You're stuck either way. So just don't do anything. Don't pray for her. Just leave her. Whatever
so
happens.
Don't put her on the Tehillim list.
Yeah, definitely not. You know, don't do
the that doesn't mean anything anyway.
Don't visit the Tehillim.com. Don't do anything. The ulam, harim shehem zarim, but other people, strangers, not family relatives. Ve'en lahem shum hashasha mikol hashashot ha'amurot, and there are no concerns like we have for the husband or the children or other close relatives. Emiyun panim aliha kedish tamut. If they want to pray for her to die. Because they see that she's suffering, so they say, you know what, Hazita, let Bori Allah just take her already, so she stops suffering. They can do what they want, no problem. As long as everything is done, Bori Allah knows whose intentions are what, and who's telling the truth and who's not. Anything dealing with the human heart, with the connection between people, have the fear of God. God knows. Don't forget. You may be telling everybody, yeah, this, that. Bore Olam knows the truth. He knows what's really, you know, your innermost feeling.
But he doesn't know the future.
Okay. Where did that come from? Okay. Final paragraph. Mikol ha'ne'ma le'el. Based upon everything we said above, Torah yosa'a shehola. Obviously, somebody is suffering a lot, sick for a long time. Doctors gave up, and there's no cure for him. And he's suffering constantly with worse and worse suffering and pain. His family members should stop praying for him to live. But they're not allowed to pray for him to die. But on the other hand, others, we'll call them Zareem, strangers, but obviously they're not strangers because they have a connection of the, you know, they're coming to see that person. They should be They can pray for the person to die so they can stop suffering. If the very, you know, if obviously their intentions are pure, Shem Shalom, the Tobato Shel HaHole, for the good of the ill person, so they stop suffering. With bad, the Tobato Shel HaHole with bad. The Shem Bohan Kadiyot Vadei.
So that's why they brought you to kill the person, because you weren't connected to the family.
To kill the person, yeah. Wasn't to kill the person, stop the suffering. The person was just suffering, going nowhere. You know, they, when the person was in a hospice and they know there's nothing they can do anymore, and family can't take the torture of the, you know, going on.
No, I'm saying they didn't do the family, so they brought it outside. That's what I mean to say.